Winter is coming. Not just a line from a very popular television show known as Game of Thrones, but the truth every Canadian in November must face. As Darlene pointed out this morning, the grass was looking a little frosty, a little crisp. So we know that winter is coming. Whether we like it, whether we celebrate the cold, or whether we can't stand it, all of us remain powerless to stop this inevitability. And so at one point, the ground will be covered with snow. So goes life in Canada. Now, I don't know, based on a variety of mobility issues, how much you enjoy looking at just fresh snow in between you and the place you want to get to. We'll use Mountsburg Baptist Church as an example. We have right here, I have a list of people to call if and when the snows become dangerous and we have to go solely online so that everybody is fine and nobody's going to slip or fall or anything like that. But let's just say hypothetically, one Sunday morning we are here for church, there's been a snowfall, and somebody didn't wake up in time to shovel the walkway. Well, this is a concern. It is an obstacle. But let's also put this in a more positive light. Have you ever walked, maybe not now, but at some point in your life, come to a field or a place where there is fresh snow? Has anybody ever just taken the time to enjoy the little bit more effort to be the first person to walk through a field of fresh snow? Anybody? Show of hands? Okay. It's not the most amazing joy of winter, but it's a simple pleasure to sort of turn back, look, and be like, look at that. There's something beautiful about a fresh field of snow, and there's something kind of fun about looking back and saying, I'm the only person that's walked here. Now, neuroscience tells us that that trip through the fresh field of snow is a good way to sort of understand what happens in our brains when we learn something new. A new neural pathway is formed. There's effort to it, there's work to it, but at the end of it, a new connection in the trillions upon trillions of connections that are in your brain has been formed. One moment, you did not know a thing. In the next moment, a new neural pathway has been formed, and you know it. And one of the great gifts I get as an educator is it doesn't happen all the time, but it does happen every once in a while. A student will say, oh, that feeds my soul. Because I was just able to be a small part, and for me, witness the changing of a person's mind. I look at the result of a new neural pathway. That's fantastic. I've also seen it in the people sitting around here too, like, oh, when we take a few moments to explore something new and something happens. You saw it happen with me when Nancy shared that she'd written. Yeah, you're not that old, Nancy. You didn't write the Book of Ruth. That's such a horrible, horrible thing to say. When she had read the Book of Ruth, this is brand new information. We saw for a moment that I was like, oh, and now a new neural pathway. So thank you. Thank you for letting whatever part of my brain walk through a field of fresh snow and create something new. This is exciting. It changes us. It also explains why sometimes new ideas are scary. Because I know everybody in this room has also physically worked out, right? We've all gone to the gym. We do yoga or Pilates or just, I mean, going back to Nancy, just bench pressing 500-600 pounds of straight metal. Good for you. She is swole. We also know that after that first day of working out, whenever we come back, I mean, in a few months, we're going to be into January. I don't want us to jump forward. And of course, we know there's always New Year's resolutions, which means usually for the month of January, every gym is twice as busy as it usually is. But by February, the numbers are gone down. And by March, it's just like it ever was till the following year. But getting in shape, getting stronger, getting healthier is a pretty popular New Year's resolution. But we also know after that first workout, the next day, how good do we feel? And then the surprising thing is the day after that, it's somehow even worse. We know that our muscles are sore, we are fatigued, we feel weaker even though we're on the path to getting stronger. Similar things happen in our brains. So sometimes new ideas are a little bit scary because it does require work. And it's work we don't necessarily see, but that the forming of a neural passageway is as important as the actual completed event. We are struggling to make sense of new information coming our way. And this is exciting, and this is wonderful. And like I said, as an educator, I love seeing it. There is a moment when you get it. A moment when your struggle pays off. Moments that change you as a person. And I want you to look at the image that I've got in the bulletin right there. I picked that on purpose because it has this sort of, this two people wrapped around each other. It is a bonding thing to grow and learn with someone. It is a bonding thing to grow and learn from someone. And as Jesus is meeting and debating with some of these religious scholars, very educated people, people who have trillions of neural pathways dedicated solely to understanding Yahweh, the law, and their role, Jesus is debating with them. And this person comes up and starts to say, okay, there's a lot of ideas kicking around here. What's the most important one? We can all relate to that. I'm like, okay, stop. What do I need to know? And Jesus says, you already know this. The most important law is love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And they says, okay. And then Jesus says, and the second one is also important. Love your neighbor as yourself. And this person asking Jesus in the midst of this debate says, yeah, I get what you're saying. I see what you're saying. In a system dedicated to offerings, to, as the author of Hebrews points out, sacrifices that make us outwardly clean, this person understood. He's like, I see what you're saying. I get it. Taking care of others is more important than the offerings we've been prescribed. And I like this moment because Jesus, you could see Jesus saying to this guy, you get it. You are very close to the kingdom of God. You understand the heart of what my dad was talking about. It's not about the prescriptions. It's not about the sacrifices. It's about the care. That's what gets you close to my dad. That's what I'm trying to communicate to you. You love God. God will help you love neighbor. You want to serve God. You serve those closest to you. You want to see God. Look at those around you. And we know Jesus pushes that because those around you are not just the ones who think the same way, look the same way, or behave the same way. Jesus says, look at God all around you. Look at the kingdom in the diversity of skin colors, in the diversity of languages, even in the diversities of understandings. And here is where our wonderful understanding of neuroscience is amazing, but falls short. Each one of us here were raised, given when we were born and how we've come up, each one of us here were raised to think that our faith is based on the proper statement or the intellectual assent to proper ideas. And they have a role. They have a place to play. But think about if we really believed getting it right is the point. Then different churches is a huge problem. And many of us here weren't raised or were necessarily ascribed to being Baptist other than the fact that we live around here, and this is very much a Baptist community church, because many of us here were raised in Catholicism. Many of us were raised with Presbyterian. Some of us were raised Pentecostal or Charismatic, but we're here. Now, if believing right was the point, that's a huge issue. You're in a lot of trouble if you left the right way of believing, the right way of worshiping, and came here. Whoop, 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 whoop. But none of us actually operate like that. Sometimes we do. But I also love the idea that the denominations, expressions of Christianity, are very similar to people's preferences in music. Some people like country. Some people do not. Some people like 90s hip-hop and rap. Some people do not. There's a shaking head. And that is okay, because some music speaks to us in ways that other music doesn't. Some artists we like more than others. Some we find too angry. Some we find too schmaltzy. Whatever. The problem being when we think that our own personal musical styles are the musical styles. Our problem with the denominations becomes an issue when we think the way our church does it is the way to do it. Because, my dear brothers and sisters, that is not backed up in Scripture. We seem to be following a God who truly creates and then celebrates diversity of humans, who loves creation to be a whole panoply, a whole mosaic, a whole different way of experiencing each other, which is why we need to constantly go back to the idea that we're called to love our neighbors. But, you might say, does that mean we can just believe any old thing? No. No, that's not what I'm saying. We have to nuance this. Because while you get it is a wonderful moment when you think or get a new idea, there's also another point that's deeper, a deeper truth in Christianity. And that's what the author of the Hebrews was doing. Holding up this well-established religious system of sacrifices and rituals, the very people that Jesus was debating, what the author of the Hebrews does is say, okay, take that system, which we talked about last time, led and employed by faulty human beings, by weak men. Some of them were good at their job, some of them weren't. But the office of high priest must maintain, no matter who is there. And so what the author of the Hebrews does is like take that system built here in this creation, occupied by weak human beings who must offer sacrifices for themselves to purify themselves first, and then offer sacrifices for others so that others get, year by year, a chance to continue in relationship with God. What the author says is for thousands of years, we've agreed that this is the proper way to have a relationship with each other and our Creator. Now, if that system of heifers and oxes and birds and blood and ashes and money and people broken, having to do it over and over and over again, we all agree was significant and sufficient to continue our relationship with Yahweh, how much more efficient is the fact that Jesus offered himself with his own unblemished blood to enter into the most holy place, not the place in the temple, but the place in the temple, the actual thing that the place in the temple was modeled after. He walks into the most holy place, not the holy of holies that's found here, but the holy place. Jesus enters there through the sacrifice of his own blood, so that now, rather than a year by year by year, by broken person after broken person after broken person, now, how powerful is that to set all our consciences free from the acts of death? This is so much more than intellectual assent, because you're not expected to get it. The author of the Hebrews is saying is, congratulations, you've got it. Because of who Christ is. Because of what Christ did. That sacrifice was once and for all, and infinitely more powerful than any of the sacrifices that have been offered before. That's the deep, deep, deepest story of our Christian faith. How we understand it, how we live it out, how we express it, how we worship, can be, I would say, infinite different ways. And if we want to come back and root ourselves, we start by loving God, and we act by loving each other. It is simple. It's just that. It's a 1-2 thing. You can get it, but the reason why this reflection is called You Get It times 2 is thanks to Christ. You get it. The it being eternal redemption. And that is where we're set free. To explore, to understand, to grow together. Some things we will get, some things we won't. Some things will be too complicated or too complex. Some things will remain forever above us. But in love of God and in love of neighbor, we get to live out the very simple, deep Christian truth. Whether or not we get it, thanks to Christ, you've got it. Amen, amen, amen.